has many concerns for these Jewish Christians. Mm-hmm. But they had not made their progress, had not made much progress, I should say, in their Christian maturity. And now that this new wave of persecution is rising and the Lord's return has been delayed, they have now began to abandon hope.
Right.
They were even right at the point, some would say, of even renouncing Jesus altogether. And I just want to say this right here, my brothers and sisters. You know, tough times has a way of showing who we really are.
Right.
Tough times has a way of showing if we are still on the meat of the word or we're still on the milk of the word. Seems like if we drift from him, God will whoop us to bring us back sometime. I wish I had somebody. And the way God will bring us back is what we call through chastisement.
Mm-hmm.
Here the Hebrew writer lets us know that a good old-fashioned whooping is still in order. The problem with many of us is that we cannot seem to look beyond the pain, the suffering, the chastisement, the discomfort, the affliction, or the anguish of it all. We ask the questions like, if you love me, why would you hurt me? When we really need to ask the question, do you love me if you don't correct me?
Right.
You see, God, he doesn't let us carry on just any kind of way. He doesn't let us just live any kind of way. Because God has this perimeter, you see. And if we step outside of that perimeter, that's when chastisement comes. But there has to be a better reason for God doing this. What is a sound reason for God's punishment? Why would he inflict pain on us and send us through the storms of life to show us that he loves us?
Right.
Well, the reason is this. It's simply because he loves us. Right. In verse 6, for those whom the Lord loves, he disciplines.
Right. Right.
Most people feel that the only way you can show love to others by giving gifts, being kind, saying nice, well, that's true. But God does not just simply stop at these things, but he also holds us accountable for what we have done.
Right.
Because he loves us, there are some things he won't allow us to get away with. I wish I had somebody. Because he loves us, he doesn't allow us to carry on any kind of way. Because he loves us, he doesn't allow us to go astray so easily.
Right.
So what does he do now? He punishes us. He will send the rain in our lives. He will send that wind to blow in our lives. He'll send days that seem to be so sunlit to others look like dark and dreary dreams. He does it all because he simply loves us.
Yeah.
And what's so special about it is that it's not just you.
Amen.
Says here he scourges every son.
Yeah.
Every son whom he receives. Which means if you are saved,
yeah,
and if you belong to him, yeah, every now and then he's going to have to whoop you. Just because you have come to the Lord, you think you are exempt from the storms of life? No way, Jose. These Jewish Christians thought that everything was going to be peachy, rosy red, now that they are with Jesus. But the Lord uses this chastisement in order to bring something to pass in them. And he's trying to develop us so that one day we might look like him. One day we might be like him. One day we might think like him. And he does it. Sometimes it's uncomfortable. We don't like it, but that's the way he does it.
Amen.
The late Garner C. Taylor, he tells about his neighbor. About one day how he caught him out cutting shrubs in his yard, and he asked him, why are you doing that?
Yeah.
His neighbor responds, he said, well, I got to keep them from becoming top-heavy. And that's the way the Lord does us.
Yeah.
Well, he has to keep us from becoming top-heavy.
Right.
And so what the Lord does, he cuts.
Right.
He prunes us.
Yeah.
He strips things back away from us.
Yeah.
So that we might transform into beautiful sons and daughters that we ought to be. So if you are getting a whooping right now in your life, if you are just going through, you just got to get a whooping, just say to yourself, the Lord sure enough loves me.
Oh, God. Sure enough.
This love, it runs deep, y'all. It runs deep. It runs deep. Because here there is this love, and there is a cause for this love. And it's simply because we are family. It says if you endure chastening, God deals with you as sons, for what son is he whom the father chasteneth not? growing up in the church, my mother was the youth advisor. You know, when your own mother is the youth advisor, some things, you know, you just can't get away with. So what she would do with me and my cousin, she would always be harder on us than she would everybody else. And the reason why was that she said she would hold us to a different standard because we had a similar genetic pool. And in like manner, God holds us to different standards.
That's right.
Because we are in a different genetic faith pool.
That's right. That's right.
The whole key about it here is about and how God deals with us because we are in the family. Because you are part of him, he's going to hold you accountable for everything that you do.
Yes,
and that's what we see here. And I thank God for, you know, we lose that accountability now in the church.
Yeah.
We don't hold each other to these standards now in the church. You know, now we got this this liberality coming up, so to speak.
Yeah.
You know, I even notice among young parents now how it seems like as they train and try to train, I should say, raise their children like the children instead of them training the children training them.
Right.
You just watch them, I just say, Lord, have mercy. Right? But the whole key about this matter is that we are different. We are not like everybody else.
Amen.
Everybody else is not in the family. While the world tells us not to discipline our children, Proverbs 22:15 says, foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, but the rod of correction shall drive it away. I know it's tight, but it's right.
Yes,
the Bible says, it said, withhold not correction from the child,
right.
For if you beat him, Lord have mercy, with a rod, he will not die.
Right.
Next verse, Proverbs 23:14 says, thou shalt beat him with a rod, and shall deliver his soul from hell.
Yeah.
Some of us may be catching hell right now, because somebody didn't whip you when they should have.
Uh-uh.
That's why you're catching it.
Right.
Somebody didn't correct you. That's why you're getting it all now. That's why you get a woman. My mother used to whoop me, and she used to put three switches together. I didn't know how old they went for someone to the ghost. God was in the room, I tell you. They didn't just, you know, and those parents, they didn't just chastise us, but they would try to get us right because if she didn't whoop me at the house, the world sure enough got a whoop.
Amen.
So showing up put on me.
Yes.
So what this Hebrew writer is saying is that if you are getting a whooping from God, that's good news.
Amen.
Because it says that you are in the family.
Right.
If you are getting away with everything, trouble hadn't come your way, if you have stolen and never gotten caught, you lied and never reaped the consequences, says that you may want to be careful because you are perhaps an illegitimate child. In other words, if you hadn't been through anything, if you hadn't suffered sometimes, you might want to check whose side you are really on.
Right.
You might want to check your own salvation.
Right.
But when I was growing up, it seemed like I would get caught for everything.
Yeah.
I said, why I gotta get caught? Skip school, get caught.
Yeah.
Making noise in the class, get caught. Talking too much, get caught.
Yeah.
It seemed like always, but I got caught because I was legit.
Right.
I was in the family.
Right.
But what it did was bring out something in me, and it called for a reaction, and it shaped my character.
All right.
What it did was made me respect my elders.
Right.
By the Lord, chastises us because he loves us. Because we are in the family, it's all for the purpose that we might respect him.
Right, right.
Some people in the church will try stuff when they don't respect you. They'll try to see what they can get away with.
Right, right.
Lord, we'll discipline us just so that we'll know don't try it again.
All right.
Some of us still won't listen.
Right, right.
God will send us through stuff and say don't try it again. We've had this Bible, been in church for years. Got the plan, got the manuscript, but we still trying stuff that we shouldn't try. God said, I'm going to whoop you. I'm going to get you. And that's what he's trying to tell them here. Don't try it anymore. So as our parents correct us, that we might respect them, so does the Lord. Respect is that trait that we are certainly losing now. Many people now respect more about the secular than they do about what is sacred. Respect what is political more than we do than is what is pious.
Right.
In order for God to pour the respect out of us, he'll put us in positions that are not most favorable. But God will inflict some of us sickness upon us. He'll inflict disease upon us. He'll inflict infirmities upon us. God will cause pain, hurt, affliction, and so many things. He will send us into the midst of the sea and let the storm rage. He'll even allow Lazarus to remain dead for 4 days. I wish I had some Bible reading. He will allow men to be born blind. He will allow Jairus' daughter to remain asleep. He will allow women with blood issues to bleed for 12 long days. But he would use all of these issues and situations and circumstances to get respect out of us. Many of us were raised, the Hebrew writer says, that our parents chastised us for a few days. And seemed best to them. When I got in trouble as a boy, not only would my mother whip me, but she would also punish me. But she did this because she thought that this was the best way to chastise me. But then he goes on to say, but he for our profit. Because you see, with all of the chastening, God is trying to get us in on something. And he will do it to make sure that we get right with him. And we see that God wants us to join in on his holiness. God's holiness must be so good that he will discipline us for it. But what he'll do, he'll chastise us for it. He'll beat us for it. He'll whip us for it. And that's good news. That the Hebrew writer's letting us know that we are not going through all this for nothing. There is tranquility on the other side of this chastisement. Now the text makes an excellent turn, because now after he tells us that he loves us and how we are family, and after all of that, he attempts to encourage us. Well, it says, now chastening seems to be joyful for the present. But he lets us know that while chastening is something no one likes, it's only for a moment. You know, my little daughter, little old Mariah, bless her heart, bless her heart. You know, at night, every night, I got to put her to sleep. And she cries, and she's dealing with that separation from being and sleeping in another room and being separated from mama and dad. And she cries, and she cries, she cries, and it hurts sometimes. But I know that I got to train her that I can't always be there to lay with you. And sometimes God does us like that. He'll let us cry sometimes. He'll let us weep sometimes. He'll let us go through the storm and the valley sometimes. Just so that we might know that there is only for a moment. Because I learned that little Mariah, after a while, she'll go on to sleep. And she'll have it after a while. And God wants us to know that though it hurts right now, it's only for a moment. So just go on to sleep and get through it. It's only for a moment. Everything that we go through down here is only for a moment. Even if it looks like they're winning, but it's only for a moment. It's only for a little while. It's painful now, but I'm glad he didn't stop writing, because he says, nevertheless, afterward it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. For it tells us that it's pain now, but then it's peace later on. There the Psalmist 30, Psalm number 30, verse 5 says, weeping may endure for a night. But you see, that's pain now. But then he said, but joy comes in the morning. That's peace. If you read over there in Psalms 34:19, where it says many are the affliction of the righteous. Well, you see, that's pain. But God delivered them from them all. That's peace. Have I got a witness? Psalm 27:2 said, when the wicked, even my enemies, came upon me to eat up my flesh. See, that's pain. Yeah. But then they stumbled and they fell. But that's peace. Have I got a witness? I'm here today to tell you that it's only for a moment. So while you are going through, you're getting your whooping, God knows love that is only for a little while.
Oh,
can I get a witness? So while you are crying and mumbling and mumbling and complaining, it's only for a little while.
Well,
you don't have to worry because you're getting persecuted in your life. But I'm here today to tell you that God, he specializes in things that are impossible.
Yes.
Can I get a witness? He specializes in things you seem to cannot tunnel through. I'm reminded about a story I got to tell you about how I was a young man coming up in a single parent home. I'm reminded of how my mother would have me to cut grass all the time. Can I get a witness?
Yes.
And when she would have me to cut grass, I would hate to have to cut grass. Lord have mercy, because when you're in the South and you're cutting grass in the South, it gets real hot out there. Can I get a witness? And I would hate to have to do yard work. Am I all by myself? Because I used to hate to have to do yard work. And when I did yard work, I would hate to have to get out there and push and pull. I would push and pull, and I would push and pull. But one of the things that kept me but keep on cutting grass is, number one, I didn't want to get a whooping. Can I get a witness? And that's the other thing. Number two is, I would always appreciate the end result. Can I get a witness? I wouldn't want to get a whooping, but I would appreciate the end result. And the end result was that I was finished cutting the grass. Can I get a witness? And I'm so glad that even though that I did all of that, that when I got to the end, can I get a witness? It was all over. And I just want to tell you that even though it may be hard right now, and you don't want to go through what you're going through, there is an end result.